Hello, Ghana.
Hi. So today we're talking about Clary Gazzoni, probably the most optimistic person you will find, and you know, despite all odds, I'd say. You know, so
right. Right. We speak about Gian Claudio Giuseppe Clary Gazzoni, and what you see here is practically his personal motto, which he mentioned later, and of course we will also discuss it when we speak about his quotes, as it not only makes us understand him, but also other drivers.
Yeah, absolutely. So, and the motto is, it's a question of heart.
Right. For the ones who are following us just on the podcast and not see us like in YouTube, it's a question of the heart.
Right. And obviously Clary Gazzoni is a very iconic figure for many people who are interested in the history of Formula One. But at the same time, again, you might not have heard about him. So, which is really unfortunate.
That's why we make this time maybe a little bit a different approach. Imagine that that you are, let's say, at the Ferrari Museum and you're walking by this car with the number 11. So you see this is the Ferrari 312 B3, but you may ask yourself, who is this Clary Gazzoni? As he is unfortunately less known as his teammate Niki Lauda, of course. Also, maybe you rediscovered him based on the movie Rush, as you see Clary Gazzoni, the character, in some few scenes of the movie.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And we will come to this also, of course.
Yeah, and like I said before, he had a very so some unfortunate events happened later in his career, but nevertheless, yes, he will always kind of keep his cool and would be very optimistic about the sport and his role in sport. So, but without further ado, let's talk about him in general. So he's actually Swiss.
Right. He's, I mean, you most likely know him as driving for the Ferrari. And of course, his name is Italian. So you may think Ferrari driver must be Italian, but no, he is originally from Switzerland.
And, Switzerland, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we will see exactly from where on the next slide. So he drove for different teams besides Ferrari, BRM, and Ensign Shadows and Williams. With this, he had 139 entries and 5 victories. No championship title, but he was second in the 1974 season. What we also will speak a little bit about, as he had quite good opportunities to win that year, but at the end it wasn't him.
Yeah, so he was indeed. He was born in Mendrisio in the Italian part of Switzerland. Yeah, that's right. And yeah, so he drove for many different constructors, as you can see, before he ended up in Ferrari, and had over 130 entries and 5 wins, which is great.
Yep. So here we show you a little bit where he's from. So he was born in Lugano, which is being the son of Pio Regazzoni, the major of Porza. Porza is the second photo, which you can see here is from 1948. So relatively around when he was born, very, very, very small little village. And later on, he worked at the workshop of his father, which was in the nearby Mendrisio, which is still a small town, but more industrial and a little bit bigger, of course, than Porsa. So as many other Formula One drivers, he was born into a family which had an own workshop. So he comes in from this, let's say, this mechanical background. In opposite, for example, to the beginning of the 1950s, where we had the gentleman drivers, which practically came from a more high society background and had the money to buy the sports cars. So this was not the case for Clay Regazzoni.
Yeah, but still, I mean, he had his family support. And
yes, yeah. Of course. But he was, say, he wasn't, I mean, he wasn't clearly not from a poor family background, but he also, I would say, like a middle class, as many others in the 1970s mm-hmm. and also in the 1960s. So here, another nice photo, which you found. We see Clay started competing in 1963 with a relative high age, with 24. So 24 nowadays, with this, you're already 3 years inside Formula One. So it's not where you would generally start with motorsports in general. Mm-hmm. Maybe one of the reasons is that he was a Swiss, because motorsports in Switzerland at that time was banned. I'm not completely sure if this is still valid today or if they've changed it maybe 10 years ago, but at least in the 1970s it was banned, and this based on the tragic accident at Le Mans 1955, where the Mercedes Silver Arrow crashed into the tribunes and killed not only driver, but also many, many spectators. So that's why Switzerland, you know, Switzerland has a direct democracy, and Swiss people decided that they not want to see motorsports inside their own countries, meaning for little Clay, he had to go outside to start with his career.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just also want to mention, so obviously he had some quick successes, and
yes,
he was relatively quickly spotted by Ferrari, but and even had the chance to get into Formula 2 with Ferrari in 1969, but his results were not great, so he actually had to revert back to Tecno team, which is a small team that we discussed before. Yeah. But he got his second chance, so this is, I think, very unique situation, because I think when Enzo Ferrari would give our Ferrari team would give up on someone, then they would not give them the second chance. I mean, this guy got the second chance, so this is quite extraordinary, I think.
Yes, and besides this, he was one of the very few drivers in Formula One who drove twice for Ferrari, so who left and returned, which is not very common.
Yeah, this is it. This is what I mean as well. So it's pretty extraordinary.
And as you already mentioned, in Formula 2, he drove practically for the Tecno team, a very small Italian team, which came originally from the karting. And and in general, I think the philosophy then inside this team, coming from karting, had been quite good aligned with Clay's driving style, which have been quite hard and always driving at the limit. So maybe not a very strategic approach, as we saw more from Niki Lauda. So Clay Regazzoni was always a hard driver since the beginning, and driving at the limit. Later on, he was also involved into a tragic accident in Formula 2, where he crashed with Chris Lambert, so leading through the fact that Lambert lost control and crashed into a bridge. There was an investigation later on, but this investigation cleared Regazzoni from responsible for the accident and for Lambert's crash, even if Lambert's father himself privately pursued him. So we had a lawsuit which went on, I think, at least for 2 years.
Yeah, I mean, I think there is a lot of commonalities between Clara Gazzoni and Nina Farina. When we discussed Nina Farina,
yes.
So we also were saying that, you know, there were kind of a lot of unfortunate events and a lot of controversies associated with his risk taking. So here I think we have a very similar picture, and again similarity in kind of starting competing in Formula One relatively late.
Yeah. And even similarities related to the background, the family background, as the Farina family also had their workshop.
Absolutely. And also later, you know, we will talk about the life-changing accident. Again, a lot of similarities between Nina Farina and Clara Gazzoni in that regard. So, yeah. So here, I mean, I guess it's quite similar characters.
Exactly. And but besides this, he had been quite successful in Formula 2 and could win in 1917 the European Formula 2 Championship.
This is, I think, a very important point to actually say that, you know, it's very difficult to concentrate when you have legal cases against you. I mean, we will leave aside whether we believe or do not believe that he was actually somehow involved in this tragic event when Chris Lambert basically was a victim, yeah, of this incident. But but essentially, you know, it also tells you about the level of concentration and the ability to pursue his racing career despite all these external disturbances that he had to encounter.
Exactly. And especially for a young person as Clay was at that time, it's of course very difficult. So really, this also underlines his skills, that nevertheless he was successful in these years.
Mm-hmm.
But nevertheless, his success in 1906, so besides driving in Formula 2, he also participated already in the 1917 25 Hours of Le Mans, where he has been paired with the more experienced Arturo Massario, racing the Ferrari 512S, which you can see, which is not the car which you can see, but a closed car a little bit before this 300 PB, and not as competitive as this 312 as in the photos. But in the beginning of the 1970s, as it was quite common, drivers not only had been inside Formula One, but also had been quite active in, especially in the sports cars series.
Right, and then he was also paired with Jackie X.
Exactly.
So quite, yeah. And I guess
so he was already a Ferrari driver at that time.
Yeah, so and I think so this is how he got back into Ferrari, so through kind of this route.
Exactly, Ferrari had a big racing team, and at the end of the year, beginning of the new season, they decided who starts in Formula One and who in endurance. And mostly the two best drivers have been chosen for Formula One, and the ones maybe not completely at the same level or with potential for the next season, they have been chosen to drive the sports cars as the 512 or the 312. Which Mario Andretti once commented that this car, the 312, is being very drivable, very similar than driving a Formula One itself.
Yeah, and I think it's also, he got lucky that Ferrari was kind of had, it was not the best period for them, kind of in the late 1960s and beginning of 1970s. And really, I think he got his second chance because simply they suffered kind of a number of, I'm not going to say failures, but an unfortunate, you know, there was a series of unfortunate events, let's just say, on the mechanical side and on the, you know, kind of choosing drivers and all that. So, yeah, so I think this was his second chance, but we have to say that he used his second chance very well.
Exactly. I mean, if you don't have the strongest car in the Formula One season, you normally cannot attract the fastest drivers, or at least the most successful drivers. So you depend a little bit on the talent which you have to develop yourself. Mm-hmm. So this had been really Clay's big opportunity here.
Yeah, so you saw this picture already if you're watching us on YouTube, and yeah, so this is so normally you see, well, if you Google it, that if you Google Clay Regazzoni's name in English, at least you will get this picture of him. But in fact, this picture is from a bigger picture with
right.
Yeah, so you can see Jackie X in this picture. So and. Yeah, and I think this is probably a team gathering of some sort of people are very patiently listening to something. Yeah.
The reason why you often get this photo is because it's from the Dutch National Archive in Den Haag, and luckily they are offering this photo for free. So this is once where you don't need special rights to include it into your articles, whatever. So that's why mm-hmm. it's a quite common photo, of course. As you mentioned, Ferrari in the beginning of the 1970s wasn't at the top, to say it that way. For example, in 1970s, they practically only participated with one car. They regularly had been driven by Jackie X, and besides this, they tried out two young drivers. One have been Ignacio Giunti and Clay Regazzoni. Clay Regazzoni really used his opportunity and finished third in the drivers' championship, and this only 12 points behind Jochen Rindt. So this was the year where he took his opportunity. And that's why Ferrari had chosen him for this 1970 season.
And then they struggled for a couple of years with the car, but it's good that they had Clay Regazzoni with them, because obviously he, like I said, he's one of those people. And again, you know, this sort of case with the court case and all this is very telling, because in a sense, he could really kind of keep his cool and be quite optimistic in very difficult situations. He eventually, like Patrick explained previously when we talked about early 1970s seasons in other episodes on the channel that you can check out, that eventually he brought in Niki Lauda, who completely changed the entire the entire way in which drivers worked in Formula One and in Ferrari in particular. Right? So
yes, and it was practically Clay Regazzoni who commented Niki Lauda as he rejoined the second time Ferrari.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. And so he definitely had a very, so this is a guy with very, very strong character, and it will be evident when we discuss his career further. Mm-hmm.
Exactly, and even if in the beginning of the 1970s the Ferrari wasn't the strongest car, had been struggling as a team, his talent had been clear to its competitors, and due to this, he received a quite lucrative offer from McLaren, which at that time had a good budget, also thanks to their new sponsor, Marlboro, and also Texaco. And with this, they could motivate Clay to switch from Ferrari to McLaren.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And in 1975, Clay Regazzoni was wasn't involved in 73. Sorry, it was he was involved in a quite heavy accident in South Africa, where after the accident he has been sitting inside the burning car, but luckily could have been pulled out by his colleague Mike Hailwood, who stopped his car to get Clay out, because at the beginning of the 1970s, unfortunately, there hadn't been the safety marshals in higher numbers around the track as we are used to it today. So drivers had to stop and pull out their colleagues, sometimes lucky, as in the case of Clay Regazzoni, as it happened later in 1973, it didn't work out to get the driver out of a burning wreck.
Yeah, absolutely. So it wasn't a very good season for him, but then, you know, in 1974, we saw a great improvement where he Ferraris were back to competition, and was Clay. And
exactly. So here we had this. What luckily sometimes happens when teams start to struggle is that normally, if you only have you know this from companies, if you only have small problems, you'd maybe try to sit out the problem or ignore the problem, and you have the attitude that we always did it that way. But if you really are struggling as Ferrari did, this really needs a bigger disruption to do something completely new to get back on track. And Ferrari, for example, they hired Luca de Montezemolo, and based on his decision, Enzo Ferrari decided to bring Clay back, as based on his experience with him as a driver, his character, but all. There had been respect between Enzo and Clay, but of course also based on his talent. And as Regazzoni was inside Enzo Ferrari's circle of trust, he could recommend somebody as the new second driver, and Clay recommended Niki Lauda, which of course brought Ferrari to the next level in the next years.
Yeah, absolutely. So 1970. So again, if we talk about Clay Regazzoni, he is one of these perfect co-pilots because in 1975 he really supported Niki Lauda's victory of his first title with basically one victory for himself and five victories for Niki Lauda for the team, and they brought in the championship victory to Ferrari as well. So it was a very, very successful season. And again, it's very important to have a team player when you don't actually have, it's nice to have a healthy competition, but also nice to have support. And this support was really provided by Clay Regazzoni to Niki Lauda.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And it's important not only to win the driver's title, but also, of course, the constructor's title, as Ferrari could achieve in 1975. So you need two strong drivers. After 76, he lost a little bit track, so his results not had been that good anymore. So that was also the reason why Ferrari replaced him later with Carlos Reutemann.
Yeah, and also, well, we have to say that he was a lot older, right? And he
Right.
was one of the oldest drivers at the time
Yes.
in Formula One competition, and also obviously he was one of the longest driver working for Ferrari, so it was
Yes.
just probably the time
Correct.
for a change, and yeah, Ferrari took that chance.
Right. Even if you have a good relation, I mean, it's like this in motorsports. It's unfortunately a competition, and if you cannot deliver, if you not deliver the results, then it's time for a change. Staying a little bit with the 1970 season, which was his most successful, you see here. He competed against a lot of big names, against Emerson Fittipaldi, Joey Scheckter, Niki Lauda, Ronnie Peterson, and Carlos Reutemann. So here you see just the results from each race. You see one time Emerson Fittipaldi winning, then Carlos Reutemann winning, Niki Lauda winning, Fittipaldi, Ronnie Peterson, and also Clay Regazzoni. He was quite stable, but only had one victory and in that season. So maybe this had been the point why he only came in as a second behind Emerson Fittipaldi, because he was very successful, but only one victory, which is a problem as you get 9 points for the victory and only six for the second position.
Yes, absolutely. And but then we also have to remember that he only lost by 3 points, which is very, very little. Yeah, very
Exactly.
little.
So here, for example, you see who had been leading. It was for a long time Emerson Fittipaldi from the fifth until the eighth race. Then the young Niki Lauda leading from the 8th until the 10th. And Clay Regazzoni led the championship from the 11th until until the 14th. And only in the very last race in the US, Emerson Fittipaldi could secure the championship for himself, the second title.
Absolutely. Yeah. And yeah, so we can say that it almost happened for Koerig.
Yes, that's right. So Clay left Ferrari, but he was, despite his age, he was still very much motivated to stay in Formula One. So that's why he accepted the offer by a relatively small team, the Ensign team. And he had an alternative option to go to Brabham, but he once responded the reason why he preferred Ensign to Brabham is that he wanted to race with nice people. So of course you may question that a little bit as if really he had the option, or what was maybe another reason, maybe it was money involved, or he didn't felt respected by Brabham, or why he thinks that people at Enzins have been nicer at people as at Brabham.
Yeah, I think it's just like in all places when you spend so many years with one team, and you've been there when you were relatively young. So I think that's
Yeah,
just
but
a different perception.
or maybe at that time, I think team principal had been Bernie Ecclestone, which had been a quite difficult character. We had leading engineer Gordon Murray, who also sometimes overstepped red lines. So Maybe it is understandable as some people are not comfortable, especially as somebody with Clay Regazzoni, he was more a direct person, that he didn't work good together with somebody as Bernie Ecclestone, who always was more political person.
Yeah, and if we look at this car, the Williams car on your screens so this is kind of the next stage of career. Yeah. For Clay Regazzoni, it has quite a lot of sponsorships from United Arab Emirates, and right. In preparation for this episode, actually found a stamp that we will show you later. The stamp is actually from United Arab Emirates, and it features Clay Regazzoni. So but if we go kind of further from Ensign team, then actually in 78 he was with Shadow, and finally in 79 Frank Williams gave him a chance to race, and of course he took it. And you know, he's just such a determined person, in the sense that, you know, he wasn't saying, oh, you know, I was a second driver in Ferrari, I'm not gonna drive for like some other team because it's kind of below my standard. But he essentially was so passionate about the sport that, and he realized how small the pool was from which, you know, the teams were selecting people, that he actually took all opportunities to drive whenever he could.
Exactly, and here we have this famous quote from him: "I love Formula One, and most of all, I love to drive racing cars. So why should I stop when I feel this way?" And I think this not only aligns to himself, but explains why we see a lot of times that aging drivers, when they have to leave the top teams, as they not provide maybe the results anymore, they go to second or third class teams, and maybe this not only because of money, but because they have the same passion as Clay Regazzoni, that they really love competing, really like driving, and they like it also if they are, let's say, in a second or third class team. So it's not only the money which is motivating the people in Formula One.
Yeah, absolutely. And so this is another, but like I said, he just I think also strikes me as a very positive person who always thinks that you know, things will turn out well. So that may be also a contributing factor here, the kind of inherent optimism of his character.
Yes, and with this, we're coming to 1980. Clay is back at Ensign. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, here at the fourth race, he had been involved in a quite heavy accident when the brake pedal of his Ensign failed. So, again, technical failure at the end of a long high speed straight traveling at approximately 280 kilometers an hour. And touched the car from Sonnino, who was parked at the escape road. And this was practically his end of his Formula One career, as after this accident, he survived, but he wasn't able to walk anymore. So after this had to use a wheelchair.
Yeah.
Regazzoni, yes.
Yeah, I just want to say that, you know, for most people, and actually for most drivers, that would kind of mean pretty much the end of not only career, but life. You know, again, in preparation for this episode, I was looking at quite a lot of pictures of Clay Regazzoni. And, you know, when he was in a good, in his best kind of sports form, you could see him kind of being quite cheerful and you know, skiing somewhere, and there are kind of pictures at his birthday party with Niki Lauda, and you know, so he's been like really, really, you know, cheerful person amongst friends. And you expect that once he had this accident and he was kind of bound to his wheelchair, then he would become a different person. But it seems like nothing changed. I mean, of course, a lot changed for him, but you know, if you look at the pictures, you will see the same cheerful person, only now in wheelchair, but kind of the same, you know, birthday with Niki Lauda. Maybe not quite skiing, but you know, him posing with some special cars for disabled people, for people with special needs, let's just say. And he became really this advocate for people with special needs since then. So he kind of reinvented himself again and still found a way to be connected to cars and drive cars. So it's amazing. I just find it absolutely amazing.
Yes, up to he continued competing in race cars. So may compare him here a little bit to Alex Zanardi, who had similar positive attitude after he only had to use the wheelchair. So somebody who carried on with his life and even continued competing on the highest level despite these limitations.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, he also sued the racing organizers for this accident in the US. But yeah, you know, you have to actually, I mean, agree with that because, yeah, I mean, the races in US at the time were a lot more sporadic and probably were falling short of the high standards that were needed. And so I mean, he drove for so many different. Obviously, Ferrari was his home, but yeah, he drove for BRM and Sign and Shadow and Williams. So yeah, great career.
I mean, 6 years with Ferrari. So that's normally the brand with whom you remember him mostly. Not only because of the time, but also of the success. So his best year had been 1974. On the photo, if you see us on YouTube, you see the 1970X car, the 312 T2. So quite a long career, 10 years in Formula One. And maybe it had been some more, one, two more, if he hadn't had the accident.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And I mean, he again started to improve. If you look at it, he was in the fifth place in 1979, so could have been, you know, maybe further improvement in 1980, but yeah, unfortunately that didn't happen for him.
Yep. And here's one of the photos where we see him in the wheelchair, and as you said, he's still very positive. You see him very passionate.
Yeah, and I want to also, if you're watching us on YouTube, so this is a picture of Clay Regazzoni at a relatively old age, but look at his physical shape. I mean, you can tell that this guy is not just sitting in the wheelchair. He's actually exercising. And so, I mean, there are a lot of pictures when he was a lot younger, obviously. This picture is from 1990s, but in 1980s, there are a lot of photos of him in kind of when he's younger. And you probably like when there is a photo of him from above the waist, you cannot even tell that this is a person in the wheelchair. Like you cannot possibly tell the difference.
Yeah, and I mean, just imagine he participated in the Rally Dakar in the 12 hours of Sebring. So he wasn't just participating in smaller events, but really something which is very challenging, independent if you are in the wheelchair or not in the wheelchair. So up to his last competitive race was in 1990, and still after this, he was still invited to test new cars. So he was quite active.
Yes, absolutely. He was very active and very optimistic person, and definitely one of the role models and one of the pioneers of equal opportunities for people with special needs. Absolutely amazing life and amazing career. Probably the only thing that would have been good is maybe a Formula One championship win,
yep.
in 1974, especially considering that Emerson Fittipaldi, who won that year, already had one one championship win. But I mean, nevertheless, I think, you know, absolutely brilliant, a brilliant guy.
Yeah. And with this, unfortunately, we have to come to his death, and it's a little bit mysterious. And you mentioned
Nina Farina, like just
right.
Nina, like if you think about it, it's like very, yes. very similar.
Right. right.
Yeah.
Right. Similar to Nina Farina, who also not only died
driving a car. Yeah, driving a car.
Do not really know why it happened, because he was driving a Chrysler Voyager. Why a Chrysler Voyager, you may ask, because normally it's more a family car, but these minivans, they offer you the option to update them, especially if you're using a wheelchair. So I assume this was the reason why he was driving a minivan. So he was driving on...
go ahead, sorry.
Okay, so he was driving, and for some reason he just had crashed into a truck before him at a speed of 100 kilometer an hour. We not really know why. There had been a theory that he had a heart attack, but later the doctors confirmed that this was not the case. So quite strange. I mean, today you may suspect that he had looked at his smartphone, but it was 2006, a little bit before smartphones. So very mysterious, and we don't know really why it happened.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of, like, in all these cases, there's a lot of speculation, you know, about potential suicide and all that. You know, we are not here to kind of make these assumptions, but, you know, this is a fact. I think still on the, if we can kind of talk about death in positive ways, at all, then at least, you know, he died at the wheel, not you know, not in yes. a hospital somewhere. So probably yeah. this is one of the so, you know, quite a few drivers went that way, and you know, he passed away again driving a car, which is probably not the worst possible scenario. But of course, it's you know, it's a shame, yeah, that he died at still at a relatively young age. So it's not really and then he was in good shape before his death.
Yeah.
And this is this stamp, like I said, it comes from the United Arab Emirates, and you can see kind of quite a typical symbols for United Arab Emirates, yeah. And yeah, it says Clara Gassoni on it.
Yeah, of course, good to have your stamp. I mean, even if I wouldn't have known that this is Clara Gassoni, I wouldn't have recognized him from the drawing, to be honest.
Yeah, that's right, but. To my defense, I have to say that it does say Clary Gassoni on the stamp.
It was not against you. I mean, you not designed the stamp.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I think he probably is portrayed obviously at a later age, at his older age, but I mean, he looks a little bit like himself, not too much like himself, but
Yeah,
anyway.
I don't know if it says the year on it.
No, it doesn't. I was trying to figure that out.
I already checked this. I just thought maybe we can check it out with a translator, but...
Okay. Yeah. I can maybe look it up.
I mean, I would assume it must be like in 1980 when he was at Williams and had all the Arabic sponsors, because there we had the clear relation to the United Arab Emirates.
Yeah, it was at the end of his career, but when exactly, I don't know. Yeah, I'll try to find out. Yeah, actually, it was produced in 1970, so we are not actually correct. Both of us are wrong. Yeah, so it's 1970s. Second European to commemorate his 1970 Formula 2 European Championship win.
Yeah, but let's say Matt makes sense as he not had his typical beard mustache at that time.
Yeah. Very strange.
Okay, with this we come to his quotes. First one: I was racing day by day with Nicky. Every race was to be to be on the top. He programmed his life to be a champion, and I enjoyed life. That was the maximum for me, and I think this clearly underlines his philosophy, which is very similar, very different than the one from Niki Lauda. So even if they had been good friends, they harmonized very good inside the team, they had been very different.
Yeah, so the next remark is quite sexist, so I'm not going to, not going to read it, but yeah, I'm going to let you read it, Patrick.
Okay, he said, if you block cars and drive like a woman, you will never become great about Niki Lauda.
So I think he meant the risk-averse approach here. It's yes. Not so we will kind of overlook the fact that he said a woman there, but yeah, it's, I think it's quite typical of the time, obviously, when we had kind of this kind of sexism in many industries. But I think what he means is risk-averse driving.
Yes, I mean, yes, I assume this was pretty much a complete different time. And this is something which you could not say anymore without getting a heavy backlash.
Mm-hmm. So the next quote we already read when we were talking about him choosing lower ranked teams, when he said that he just loved Formula One and was wondering why should he stop. So I'm just going to read the next quote. So if he'd been a cowboy, he'd have been the one in the black hat. So this is Johnny Schechter talking about Clary Gazzoni. So yeah, and this is true. Very risk taking approach to a lot of situations, taking sometimes crazy risks. So like I said, I mean, to me, he just reminds me of Nina Farina. So it's a very similar character, but at the same time, very. So I think Nina Farina was majorly kind of single driver, right? Where I think Clary Gazzoni, his difference from Nina Farina was that he was really a team player. He was a real team player.
Yeah. Yes, I completely agree with you. And some more quotes. First one: if I have a big fault, it's that I'm not ambitious enough. I drive for me, sure, but also for the team and the public. And exactly this, what you said, he says that he's driving for the team and for the pleasure of the public. So maybe what he thinks about himself, that he was maybe not that egoistic, what you maybe need to become a champion If you see somebody as Ayrton Senna or Michael Schumacher, who had been sometimes a little bit more egocentric, and that's maybe sometimes what you need to win the championship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he also said that it wasn't the money that was so important. I like to race with nice people, so that's a very, very important thing. So that's what Patrick was describing when he kind of moved to Ensign and he didn't like the people there, so he didn't quite feel that it was his thing. So it was important for him to be in a good team, surrounded by people who are really passionate about what they were doing. And so, yeah, it to him, it does matter. Like, team does matter. Being someone's teammate matters. So he's really a team player.
Yes, but to be fair, he said this later in his career, when he already earned enough money.
Yeah, yeah,
so,
but
he wasn't dependent anymore on the money.
Yeah.
And the last quote: For a long time, I felt very sorry for myself. But when something like this happens, you move into a different world, a world you never thought about. You see little children with cancer, you feel ashamed. You've had years of good life, which they will never have. I can't walk, but I can drive my Ferrari. I have my driving school for handicapped people. I can still go to races. I didn't feel desperate anymore. So here he sees this personal mindset that he had to be thankful for the life he had and still has, because there have been people, to be honest, which have been much worse than the destiny than he had.
Yeah, yeah, and also, I mean, it's just his ability to kind of bounce back and enjoy life no matter what happens.
Right. Is this, let's come about his legacy.
Mm-hmm.
You may call it a question of decoro, which is in the English
question of
what
heart.
We already said. A question of heart, and I think this is practically his life philosophy. That's why it is also the claim for his little museum, or also for a movie. The biography, which was written about him. I think in the first edition, it was still written together with him, and this was the fitting title because it really reflects perfectly his philosophy. I said he has his little museum, the Clay Regazzoni Memorial Room. It has a website. I'm not quite sure if it's publicly open or if you have to ask the people before that you want to visit them. And here you see some of his private cars, the famous Ferrari, and also Ferrari F40, which I assume he has to buy himself, because Ferrari is giving away these supercars only if you won the championship.
Mm-hmm.
So luckily he wasn't dependent on the money. So and also to free to spend some of it for, let's say, some nice toys.
Yeah, and obviously, I mean, there is a big emphasis on people with special needs and mobility in this museum. So, memorial room, let's just say. So, so this is another focus of
exactly. So, and this
collection.
Is the place where you can finally visit this little car. It's the number 11. Besides this, and we discussed it, he was very active for handicapped people, having his own organization, supporting scientific research, especially supporting paraplectic people. And so he was really active and not only co-founder, but also member of the committee for this research.
Mm-hmm.
So he may be also, for example, I may imagine an example for Alex Zanardi after his accident, because it was quite similar.
Yeah,
and also
absolutely.
I think both people with a very positive attitude.
Well, and I guess for Niki Lauda as well, right?
So, yes, for a lot of people, right? Also for Niki Lauda, you're right. He also came back after this accident and had to look on the bright side of life, as the accident marked him for life.
Yeah, but Niki Lauda is a completely different character, so we will talk about him separately. But you know, I think having Clay Regazzoni example, kind of, or Clay Regazzoni on his side actually also helped.
Yes.
And by the way, yeah, so this is very topical, the film Rush, where, Clay Regazzoni's character is also present.
Yes, he's not, the story is, of course, not primary about Clay Regazzoni, but you see him in some scenes, and it's also especially in some scenes where you understand that Clay and Niki Lauda had been two completely different characters. You see Clay Regazzoni enjoying his life, while Niki Lauda practically only wanted to work, work, work. So some small scenes, but it makes you understand very good the difference in character.
Yeah, again, we kind of tell you to be mindful that there is a big exaggeration, I think, about the rivalry.
Yes.
So, you know, it's, I think it's significantly exaggerated in the film.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, I mean, just to watch this film to understand the time and the context in which these people existed and competed, it's a very good film.
Exactly. Niki Lauda said once that it's 80% correct, which is for a Hollywood movie is quite good, I think.
Yeah. So I'm just saying, of course, take it with some sort of, with some thought that it's not 100% historically accurate, that this is actually, there is some kind of fiction to it and some artistic additions and
Indeed. And that's all we have for today.
Yeah, so great character, and was really a joy to talk about him, and great to be able to discuss his life and career. And we hope to see you later in our next episodes.
Yep, we hope. Hope you like it, and again, see you hopefully in our next episode.
See you. Bye.
See you. Bye.